is brought to you by Dr. Claw.
Hi, this is Shannon from Voices of Defiance, a podcast member of the Gunna Geek Network, just like the one you're listening to now. The opinions expressed are those of each individual. Check out all the other podcasts at GunnaGeekNetwork.com. And get ready because geekiness begins in 3, 2, 1.
This is it. The part of your week where you get to put your headphones on, relax, and listen to a bunch of geeks geek out about geeky things. They're passionate.
I'm an IT guy. You should never delete. Most of the time you delete, you regret deleting.
They rage.
You guys are being like hypersensitive with your point to be offended. Oh, he deleted his Twitter account. Oh, I'm mad. What?
And sometimes they're even funny.
Tell your wife that I said hello again and sorry I couldn't be there tonight.
That's okay. Your wife says hi too.
Let me emphasize that. Sometimes. Welcome to the GunnaGeek.com podcast.
Hello and welcome to episode 121 of the GunnaGeek.com podcast. Sorry, I should do that quietly for SP. Hello and welcome to episode 121 of the GunnaGeek.com podcast. I'm Stephen Jondrew, and with me today is Stargate Pioneer.
And I am Stargate Pioneer. Welcome to GunnaGeek.com podcast number 121. How you guys doing tonight?
Oh, man. I got to edit that later because you don't have a compressor. And we also have Chris Farrell for real. For all?
My ears are bleeding.
And also rounding it off, the most important person, JS. What's up, JS?
I'm the French-Canadian sensation, and you can't live without me.
That's so true, actually. You know, I do not want a life where I don't know you, JS.
Well, it's kind of a normal thing.
Just what all the ladies say?
That's what all the ladies say, my friend.
Does that mean that I'm a lady? Is that what you're getting at?
You've been a lady for a long time.
It's like here in the United States where you get those alerts when you have sex offenders in your neighborhood. That's why you want to know where JS is at all times. Oh, I'm just saying.
What are you implying?
Oh, man.
That is not cool, man.
I want the listener to know that I have been around JS lots of times before, and only 3 times has he tried to grope me. So that's all.
Was the groping successful? Did you enjoy
under legal circumstances?
That question is, did you like it?
Obviously, who wouldn't? It's JS, for crap's sake.
There you go. So there's no problem.
That's right. If it's consent, it's good.
Oh, man. Well, let's go ahead and move into the news. But first, before we do that, I just want to go ahead and remind everybody that we are part of the Gunna Geek Network. And you can definitely find also on the Gunna Geek Network a variety of shows, including the Starling Tribune. The Starling Tribune, the reason it's not called the Star City Tribune is because Arrow decided to change a bunch of random things. But they are indeed an Arrow fan podcast. And in the latest episode, Season 4 edition Lost Souls, Chris, Neil, and SP are back to recap episode 6 of the 4th season of Arrow. Sarah might be losing it, but all is not lost as Team Arrow is able to rescue the long-missing Ray Palmer, aka the Atom. So please go to GunnaGeekNetwork.com and check out that episode of the Starling Tribune featuring Neil and a couple other guys.
So you made a joke about the fact that they changed it to Starling to Star City. I own the domain Star City Tribune, and it remaps to StarlingTribune.com.
I know. That's why I said it, because I knew that you had the domain.
The funny thing is, we were joking about it when we were recording the podcast. I was like, I wonder if that's out there. And I was like, holy crap. And then just bought it right up.
That's funny. I think GunnaGeek.com still available. Still available.
You better buy it up. We're expecting that podcast on the network soon.
All right. Well, let's go ahead and move into the news. Shall we do that?
News.
Come on. That bump's appropriate with Steven's news.
All right, we'll go ahead and start off with mine. In news this week, what you may not know. Okay, so here's the situation. Everybody always goes, you know what wins the internet? Porn. porn always wins the internet. Not true, because apparently Fallout 4 ruins everything, including porn. That's right. The website Pornhub has reported that, yes, indeed, the day of Fallout 4 release, they saw a large decrease in traffic. Yeah, that happened. So apparently the only thing that beats porn is Fallout 4.
It's hilarious. If you see the article, they had like a 10% traffic reduction for like the core hours right after the game had come out.
I actually noticed a traffic reduction, which I'm sure isn't true. Like it was just my imagination, but big game releases always have had people not show up to work, or it's proven.
Yeah.
I mean, let's be honest. Some of us on this podcast have done it.
not me.
I have not, but tons of people at my work do. They were talking about it for Call of Duty. They were talking about it for Battlefront. They were talking about it for Halo. So there are people that do it, not for every game. There are some people that do it for every game, but there are some people that do it just for the games that they like, or consoles that they like, or whatever. So good on you.
Or the movies that they like too.
Yeah. And by the way, I should mention, this news is courtesy of the newest edition of the Gunna Geek Network, which is Nerd Alert News, something that we told you about a couple episodes ago. That is Chris's news project. So, Chris, thank you very much for supplying me with said information.
I don't like that show. I think the host is a pretentious D-bag.
He's bald. Bald people. You should never listen to bald people.
Never listen to bald people. They're a-holes.
I agree. 100%.
How can they be good at something if they can't even grow hair?
I know. It's the simplest thing ever. Just grow some damn hair and maybe we'll believe in you.
By the way, before we move on in the chat, Suncast brings up a very, very good point. I would say that it's astute, wouldn't you? It's gamers like porn. That's what it is.
Yeah, but you don't watch porn while you're playing.
Not
some people do.
I was going to say, if you're good, you do.
Well,
that's what dual monitors are for, man.
Okay, let's be real here. Let's be totally real. Everybody remembers Duke Nukem 3D with the topless ladies and the strippers. Come on.
Yes.
Come on. The pixelated titties. Yeah.
Jess, we know you can rock the dual monitors. I can tell because I can see Fallout 4, the reflection of your display case right now.
Gotta maximize my time, man.
That's good.
I got limited gaming time.
You know, it's funny. My wife actually asked about that. She's like, how come JS is never looking at the camera? I'm like, look at his reflection behind him.
Yes.
Those are Easter eggs, man. Easter eggs.
But I honestly think that this is phenomenal that there is actually a decrease in porn viewing when Fallout 4 came out. I never thought I'd see the day, but hey, there you go.
I think it's hilarious, and it's not because I'm a porn expert here or anything, but you always see little news stories. Yeah. Pornhub always jumps on all this stuff like, hey, here's what happened with this trend, and here's how it impacted our website, because they get free press out of it. It's hilarious.
Stop, it's true.
Stop lying. You're a complete porn expert.
I'm actually watching porn right now in the second monitor. I purposely made sure it wouldn't show up in the reflection for me, though, so it's in this monitor on the right.
Yeah.
You're actually making porn right now. This is a recording of you.
This is.
All right. Well, let's go ahead and move on to some better news. SP, what do you got going on this week?
Look, I'm going to look at the camera. Camera!
I don't know if you want to call this better news or not, but J.J. Abrams, who, of course, is the director of the new Star Wars movie, The Force Awakens, he did an interview with Wired, so you can go to Wired and see read the whole thing. But in it, there's another website, EpicStream, pointed out that, hey, he said that he admitted that Star Trek Into Darkness and Super 8 had story problems. No, duh. I mean, come on.
There was no story problems.
And then
he
talked about the whole secret stuff, too, and everything. And I just want to say, we are in I wouldn't say golden age, but we are in an age where we're getting a heck of a lot of great effects movies that just simply wouldn't have existed 20 years ago, whatever. I just watched Interstellar this past weekend. Really enjoyed the movie, but it had story problems. I'm like, oh, it was just so close. And it just didn't hit the mark.
Did you know Spielberg was supposed to direct that movie?
Yeah, and Spielberg also has been missing the mark left and right in recent years as well.
Oh, yeah.
And I just want to say, if you're going to put that much effort into the movie, maybe, take a look at Star Wars, right? The original Star Wars in 1977. The effects were a huge thing, but they had to craft the story that made a lot of sense to people back then, right? So the art of making the movie was a lot better back then than now. Now, granted, there are some stories nowadays that are really good, but it's only the people that are really putting the effort into it to get out a great product. And I'm just hoping J.J. Abrams does that with Star Wars. I think Big Brother Disney is over him saying, no, look, dude, you got to make it good here. So he's got some help. And even George Lucas had some help with the original Star Wars. But for people that are making, like Christopher Nolan with Interstellar and a few others that I'm sure we could rattle off, I'm like, come on, guys, you're just so close. It would have been so, like Jupiter Ascending, right? That could have been a good movie. It was not. Sorry.
So. In a different universe. But, I mean, Interstellar was, I gotta say, I enjoyed Interstellar. It was quite a decent movie. I'm very afraid of the new Star Wars, I'm not gonna lie. It's a Disney property now, so we all four of us know that, and the listener knows, it's going to be milked to the bone. I'm very disappointed. I walked into a Chapters yesterday or a couple of days ago, I don't remember, and I saw the new Star Destroyer design, which blew my bubble because I'm a huge Imperial fan. I'm afraid. I mean, the movie's going to be, a lot of things are going to be in that movie. They weren't supposed to be in that movie, but have been put in that movie to make toys, or to sell toys. That's just...
Well, that's how Star Wars has worked since the very beginning, JS. They always put stuff in there to sell toys. Lucas made more money off of toys than anything else in the last two of the original trilogy.
I know, and let's be real honest with everyone. Apart from Empire Strikes Back, there's nothing that's really... I mean, Star Wars was amazing in 79, it's really out there, but have you rewatched it recently? Mind you, we're accustomed to sci-fi, we're accustomed to this and that, and that we're desensitized, but I mean, Star Wars A New Hope, how much of a good movie?
I enjoy it to this day, but I can see your point. It is, any movie from that time period is going to wear it like Close Encounters on the Third Kind. That was a little long in the tooth in places, right?
But it's good. But that's a good movie. It's a very long movie. But to me, that's a movie that's withstood the test of time, where even the special effects, you don't visually see, except I don't want to ruin it for people who haven't seen this 30-year-old movie. But, you know, until the end, you don't really see the aliens. Right. So they don't, like, the special effects really aren't bad. They still.
Right. And they mask the aliens, they mask the alien ship and whatever. And that was because they didn't have a way to visualize it. Today they would show them. And
yes, of course. Which would make that movie very bad.
Yeah. So it's a little bit of the mystery in movie making that I don't think really exists today, because if you show it like that, people are like, oh, they just didn't have the effects budget to go ahead and do it, and oh, it just ruined the movie. So they're in a no-win situation right now. But I think the story is going to be key. If you can make a good story that makes sense, that's almost timeless, it's going to be a good movie. I think Star Wars will be like that, but there are movies that J.J. Abrams have done that is not. And Star Trek Into Darkness, there was a major thing in that movie that still grates me today. And I know a lot of people have major gripes left and right with the movie. Super 8, that if I was a kid, the Super 8 would have been like an E.T. for me, right? But it missed that mark, really.
I agree. Ooh, agreed. Agreed.
You mean you don't like the fact that they cured death?
Why
they cured death?
Yeah, he's talking about Into Darkness.
Into Darkness.
What do you mean they cured
Khan's death? Khan's magic blood brought Captain Kirk back to life.
Brings everybody back.
Can we
to
talk?
Life.
Yeah. Okay, I didn't know you were going with that. Can we talk about the search for Spock? Like, come on, it's the same thing, man.
It's the same thing.
But
Con, you
but
mean?
The
search for Spock.
Search
for Spock is what brought him back.
The search for Spock, what brought him back was the Genesis device.
It doesn't matter. It's still a thing.
It's a little bit. It's a little bit more than just some dude's blood. Let's come on. Let's be honest. And I mean, what's the? Let's say Con. What I don't understand is why would they cryogenically freeze Con and send him into space if his blood has this type of like superpower? Why didn't they just keep Con frozen in a fridge downstairs in a basement and just cure absolutely every disease?
Because they might not have realized it in ancient Earth in comparison to Star Trek times is that, oh my God, this cures death. McCoy only realized it because he tried it.
So, but from now on, I hope they kept Con in like a container, right?
Yeah, like, he's frozen again at the end of it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But that's it. So they're going to like, none of the characters can die. They just have Con blood frozen in like an emergency container, like break glass in case of emergency.
Yes.
Unless you're disintegrated, then you can't regenerate.
Okay, but
how do you know?
But
how do
sci-fi you
know mix the blood and just go like
mix the blood with the ashes.
Sci-fi is notorious for doing this though, where they set something up and they're like, you know, we could do this, and then it's convenient when it's there. Like, even you know, let's look at Arrow and the Flash for crap's sake.
Let's not look at Arrow and the Flash.
You do know who you're talking to, right? I know
my opinions of those movies.
Stargate SG-1, the triple zat to disintegrate a body. Yeah, that if that is rebooted, that triple zat will not come back. That was stupid, and they admitted it. Was stupid. It was a plot device early on in the season that they would have loved to have gotten rid of, but they were stuck for it for all the mm-hmm. series after that. So yep. That is an example that they're going to change if yeah. they come back. And I hope
that's what makes a really good sci-fi movie. Well, like we were talking about Close Encounter, it doesn't create these plot devices that gets people out of things miraculously. That's what makes a good movie. So there are movies out there, and I'm just not flashing on them, but there are timeless movies where you can go, okay, so there's flaws. There's always going to be flaws with movies, but there's no cheap, gimmicky way to get out of something. You know, like there's no magical spaghetti flying monster that comes and resurrects you with like
your Deus Ex Machina.
Original Terminator with time travel, which is not possible.
Sure. I mean, the original Terminator has flaws, technically. I just mean, there's some, like, just go back and kill Sarah Connor's mom and dad.
So time travel is the hardest thing ever to debate in sci-fi movies. It is. Because there's multiple theories of time travel. There's Star Trek theory. There's quantum leap theory. There's all sorts of different theories about how time travel would work and the effect it would have after you go back mm-hmm. in time. Look at, like, Heroes and things like that. I hate debating time travel.
It's because
there is no right or wrong. It's just open to interpretation of the universe you're in, I think.
It's like Back to the Future falls apart when you realize that Doc Brown, when he ends up going back at the end of the first movie, he could have just gone back to where Marty first showed up and sent him with everything he needs to get back to the present, and nothing would have changed, right?
Come on. It's only 30 years old. You can't spoil it yet.
Oh, sorry. Warning. But the whole, like, time travel, it doesn't matter. It falls apart. Unless everything's gone back to perfect, the whole thing just falls apart.
Actually, Back to the Future is one of the best at trying to adhere to a consistent timeline in a time travel movie, actually.
That's true.
And you would not expect that for the kind of movie it is.
They've tried hard, too, especially since there was a big joke because they had Marty McFly's girlfriend in the car at the end of the first movie.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And for continuity, they had to have her in the car in the starting of the second movie. So they did try with that movie. But to get back to time travel movies, a time travel movie that I liked a lot was Looper. I don't know if you've seen that movie. That was
mm-hmm. I have not seen it yet.
I have not.
It's excellent. Yep. It's a good movie.
But I guess that takes us to the end of whatever news point we were on. Chris, what do you got for your news?
So I make fun of Comcast a lot. I'm actually not going to this time. They've done something that's actually pretty cool. They have launched a $15 streaming television service over the web, and what's cool about it, it's $15 a month, that includes your taxes and fees, It includes all of your local channels, HBO, on-demand movies, and TV shows. Now, that sounds great until you see the catches. Right now, it's only in the Boston area and Chicago. Coming to Seattle shortly, and they're hoping to bring it out nationwide by early 2016. So the second catch, if you want to get access to this streaming program, you have to subscribe to Comcast Internet. So if you're in an area that doesn't get Comcast, you can't subscribe to their streaming TV service.
I'm not seeing a catch here because Comcast is the greatest thing ever.
Yeah, okay, that's true.
And as you know, I'm Canadian, so I legitimately have no experience, but I've also pretty much had every person in the States that I know complain about Comcast. So there you go.
So I can't complain right now. They gave me a good deal and my service has been solid. This streaming plan is actually really interesting to me. I think it could be incredibly successful because it's not the first time they've done something similar, because there's some college campuses. I want to say Drexel University. They actually sold streaming plans to students. Instead of getting a cable connection in their room, they bought an online pass basically to watch all of their shows through a Comcast portal. So they've been playing with that before, and with the service I have from Comcast, actually, I can watch live TV on my computer. I can access my DVR and watch on demand. So I think what they're doing is just taking that service they've already established for cable customers and extending it to cord cutters, which really intrigues me. Cord cutting is going to become huge in the next few years. It's been steadily growing, and I think we're about to hit that point where it just blows up. In a good way, not a bad way.
If you're already paying for streaming services and then you have this big, huge cable bill for $200 on top of your internet, why keep that? Just keep the internet and stream everything. Exactly. That just seems to be logical to me.
Yeah, I mean, the only catch is
satellite's extremely too expensive.
Yeah, the only catch with this is you don't get a DVR, but most things go on demand like the day after it's already aired. So you basically have a DVR in regards to on-demand content. So $15 a month, I think, is incredibly competitive. It's a shot across the bow to Sling TV. They're saying, look at all the stuff we're offering. This includes HBO, and we're only $15 a month. That's pretty cool. It's going to be a very interesting content war you see going forward on streaming services.
I agree. I think that it's definitely the way that things need to progress in order to move along cord cutting. I like it. I think that's a great idea.
If I got sports, I would seriously consider cutting the cord with that. I'd get my locals, but I don't think that gives me ESPN and things like that, which is what I need for football and basketball season.
Sports?
Or this Fox.
Is streaming live sports on the internet from websites, is there laws against that?
Technically, like, honestly, it's probably a copyright violation, rather, unless it's through an official thing. Like, I can watch officially on ESPN's site all the stuff that they would stream, and CBS, you can watch the stuff they officially do. But if it's a bootleg stream that someone is just broadcasting live, they always have these, the promo or whatever at the top of the show, something says something to the effect of, this is not for a rebroadcast without the express written consent of the NFL. And basically someone is rebroadcasting it, which is illegal and a violation.
And let's be honest, CBS, terrible commentary. Terrible.
Well, it's no secret, I like University of Minnesota hockey. So it's college hockey. So it's second tier to begin with. So it's very difficult to find that when you're not living in Minnesota. And there are some streaming options available. So there's a Fox Sports package that I get on cable that I can see the games. But Big Ten now, and I'm absolutely certain that this is the case of all of the major conferences, they actually stream through their networks as well, in addition to showing the games online. Because let's face it, Big Ten Network, you've got 12 major schools there, you've got one channel, there's multiple sporting events going on at any one time. There's no way you're going to be able to cover everything with one channel. So it's just not happening. So they do that. They do stream sports that way.
So one last thing on this story that I just thought of is, it comes with HBO included with this subscription. So presumably that would give you access to HBO Go. And this is all $15 a month. You know how much it costs to get HBO now on the web?
$20 streaming a month, version? Right?
Oh, it's $15 a month. So basically this deal you're getting from Comcast gives you, you could look at it this way, you get HBO with all of your locals and on demand for free with it. That's kind of a cool twist on things.
I wonder how they sold that to HBO, because HBO is not getting the same cut on the streaming as they would through the online version. Well, maybe they're deliberately going low.
So I know the way they've come to me before with HBO when they offered me a new deal or called before I switched back to cable on a new deal is that they would give me cable service. I would not even have to get the box set up, but they would up my internet and they would give me access to HBO. I'd have a subscription on the box that's never connected, so I would get access to HBO Go. So they were literally selling me an HBO subscription that I would never use over cable, but just use to access HBO Go. No joke. They've been doing that for a while now. It's part of their effort to get cord cutters to come back, as they're offering these great deals. We'll lower your internet service as long as you sign up for TV. We don't even care if you install the boxes, and we'll give you HBO with it.
You know what's interesting, though, about the cord cutting is Suncast brings up a very, very good point, and it's something that does make it difficult, is that a lot of shows don't always get put online in their entirety. And that's
really
it's a fair point.
Yeah, I mean, if you go, I know you don't like Arrow and The Flash, JS, but for instance, if you go on the CW's website, it's only the most recent 5 episodes you can get on there.
And they were pushing it hard, both The Flash and Arrow, when before it started to roll off the opening season, they were counting it down. They're like, 5 more days to watch the first part of the season, 4 more days. Like, they were counting it down.
But all the episodes are available on iTunes, and I just want to point out that Game of Thrones was the big problem that people had with HBO. Look, I don't have cable. I don't have satellite. I'm streaming everything through Netflix or Hulu Plus or Amazon Prime. There is no way that I can get Game of Thrones because HBO didn't play with any of those platforms back then. Now, at least they're streaming with HBO Now, so at least that's something. But there are shows like that today that you just don't see online. So I think that they're, what I was getting at before with this $15, I think they're deliberately going low, as you said, Chris, to get the cord cutters, the people that have already severed ties, and to stop them from illegally downloading the shows and to pay something for it rather than nothing at all.
Is it illegally downloading or is it sampling, JS?
So I know streaming is a big problem. I know there's still a gray area about downloading and sampling in Canada. I mean, you know, if you're sampling everything, I don't think a judge is going to give it to you, right? But I mean, the law's there. The law's there and you can apply it.
I'm sorry. I missed everything you just said. I was too busy trying to see what was happening in your game as you stopped. I was watching your reflection, trying to analyze. I saw somebody walking towards you.
So one last point on this before we close it off. I think with this $15 price point, they also make it very easy for someone to make, oh, I missed this show. I don't necessarily want to wait for it on demand. I'll go on iTunes or I'll go on Amazon and I'll just buy the episode. $15, you know, just so you can turn on a TV show and have something live streamed to you, it might be worth it for that. And you could still buy stuff through the actual marketplaces because $15, that's almost couch money for some people.
It is. But considering people's subscriptions nowadays, it goes quick, man. I think I have like 5 or 6 subscriptions. It's coming up to like $50 a month, $60 a month.
So yeah, that's true. If you have Netflix streaming, that's what, $9-$10 a month. If you have Amazon Prime, that's about $10 a month. If you have Hulu Plus, what is that, $12 a month?
So I have RDO.
Okay,
RDO membership and which I'm considering switching to the Google Play. But I mean, it's the same price.
Yeah, they're the same. Yeah.
But see, I think I kind of justify the Amazon one to myself because I'm like, hey, I get free photo storage with this and I get access to a bunch of music and videos. Oh, and 2-day shipping. So for me, it's more the convenience of 2-day shipping with all these extra perks.
That's the only reason I have Amazon Prime, and the video is just bonus with it. Yeah, absolutely. Right.
And then up here in Canada, they've got several providers that are now doing their own service that they used to have to tie it to an actual provider. Like Shaw has their own, and then I think it's a Shaw Bell joint project or whatever you want to call it, and then Rogers has one, and one's called Crave. What's the other one, JS? It's Crave. And yeah, anyways, they're now deciding that they are going to allow it to anybody, like a Netflix thing. And the problem is, up here, licensing already was a pain due to some weird laws, and it's a big hurdle for Netflix Canada. If you've ever heard, pretty much everybody always laughs at the Netflix Canada library compared to the Netflix US. It's the same sort of thing here. Is now we're going to have an even finer scope of what the providers will offer, because they're going to start grabbing different rights, and it's going to be a problem. I think
that program that service that you're talking about, there was this completely anti cord cutter program in Canada. I don't know the name of the provider, but it agglomerated, I don't know if that's the right word in English, but it consolidated all of these TV stations into one for $5 a month. So you could, it was a Netflix
type. I remember hearing about this.
It was a Netflix type for TV stations, but it was TV stations. And but you had to have the TV stations or a subscription to a like a cable distributor like Videotron or Cogeco or Telus or something like that. And you'd pay $5, which is nothing. It's an extra $5 a month, but you'd have all that content that's broadcasted. You can have it online, which is a great idea. $5 extra a month to have that. It's nuts. But it goes completely against cord cutting because you have to have those cable packages.
Mm-hmm. Show me. Show me was the other one. Crave and show me. Yeah. Yeah. But I think it's an interesting step, Chris. And I'm a little jealous of the option that you have.
Well, I don't have it yet. I'm not in one of the pilot sites. And the rumor is it'll come in 2016, everyone. But that's no guarantee. If this doesn't work out, I wouldn't be shocked if they went, oh, we tried. And be like, we wash our hands of it.
Oh, you know the truth. The truth is that it'll work out. It'll work out. That's my thoughts. But I suppose it's going to go ahead and take us to the end of the news. So shall we move on to our next segment?
Let's do it.
All righty. All right, this week we have a bit of a special segment. We've talked a lot about TV so far this episode. Well, we're going to keep that ball rolling, and we're going to talk about sort of our initial impressions of the first few months of fall TV. Now, some of the shows, it might be a little odd, because some of the shows I know are starting to get towards their winter hiatus. Absolutely, like you're going to look, there's Sleepy Hollow that's ending. I don't know. That's the only one I can think of, but I know there's other ones.
Do you mean their mid-season finale, Steven?
You know what's funny about it? I've noticed that they're not actually using that term anymore. They're now calling it the winter break or something stupid like that.
Wait for Walking Dead in a couple weeks. They'll say mid-season finale, I guarantee it.
I know, but seriously, mid-season finale was such a buzz phrase the last couple years, and I've heard a couple different networks advertise it differently this year, so I don't know what it is. But anyways, yes, it is. Some of them are coming up to the mid-season finales. Some of them are coming up or just starting. There are some that are only a few episodes in, Supergirl, for example, and even Arrow and The Flash are kind of halfway in between. So we thought this was a good time to do a check-in and talk a little bit about what we're loving, what we think needs improvement, and some of the ones that have maybe we thought were sleepers and sure enough have surprised us. So we've got a bit of individual lists here tonight, and let's just go around the table and start off with SP. SP, what is your go-to TV series so far this year? Well, this
definitely
fall.
Definitely Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. It has been some phenomenal TV. I've seen multiple articles call it, if you're not watching it, is one of the top 7, top 10, top 5, whatever shows that you might not be watching. It has just been incredible. They had a wonderful episode, which was out of their norm, 4,722 hours, which I don't think they could have done even last year. Definitely not the first season. They have just upped the game every single episode. And I'm not just saying this because I do a podcast on it. I do a podcast on it, so I watch it every week, but I would be watching this every week. This would be my go-to thing that I watch every single week, regardless, whatever. And there's a couple more shows like that, but I would say Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. by far is my top show in the bag of shows going on this year, by far.
You know, I have to say, like, I don't know that it's my top show, but it is one that I've really, really enjoyed this year. And the episode that they did, whatever it was, 4,822 hours and 54 minutes or whatever it was.
And 17 seconds.
It was a phenomenal episode. And to date, up until that point, there has been times that I've not liked the show, and there have been times that I thought it's been a very, very good show. Even the integration with Captain America Winter Soldier, I thought was really, really good and was a good movement for the show. I never, ever, ever thought of it other than something that was a nice tie-in to the movies that I love. yes, it was entertaining each week, but I always thought that it was very much part of that bigger universe, and a lot of what they did required that bigger universe. When they did this 5,742 hours episode, I thought that it was just a phenomenal movement for that show. It held its own. It showed a different side of the TV show. And they did an episode where they showed one of the characters the entire episode and then one random new guy, and you still felt it. Like, I just thought that they did a phenomenal job with that episode.
It's been the crux of the fall part of the season right now, because it raised a lot of questions that still haven't been answered, while there's four or five main other stories going on in the show as well. So you have these episodes that are packed with stories, consecutive stories, and usually think about TNG, right? You had an A story, a B story, and a C story. They're all A stories, and you don't have three of them. You have five or six or seven of them. So they're doing a good job of bringing it all together, of continuing the storylines as they're going forward. Think of it in terms of a comic book, except for not just the single issue of the compendium, maybe, of you're getting little snippets here and there, but you're getting the whole story as the series moves forward. So I just really enjoy it. And because of the inserts into the other parts of the universe, whether it's the Netflix series, whether it's the Marvel Cinematic Universe, whether it's other movie houses now, it's all one thing. And that's, it's great that Marvel's doing it. I'm glad I'm seeing it right now, because I know it's not going to last forever. At some point in time, probably when Kevin Feige leaves his position, things are going to get a little wonky for a while, and they might not ever recover. So we'll just hang on for a few more years, enjoy it, and see where it leads us.
For sure. For sure. Anybody got any other comments about Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D.?
No? I think it's been solid, but I'm a week behind myself, so I'll get caught up soon.
I'm 2 seasons and 10 episodes behind.
That's funny. Okay, Chris, what do you got on your top show this year?
So, I don't know if I have a top show from anything new, to be honest. So if I had to pick a top show of the things I'm watching right now, I'm kind of leaning either Walking Dead or South Park, in all honesty, because South Park continues to be some of the best satire on TV, I think.
Do you watch Rick and Morty?
I have not watched much Rick and Morty. I have watched a bunch of it, but I'm behind.
Okay, season two is just glorious.
Yes. I have enjoyed South Park taking shots at everyone this season, though, and they're doing another story arc where literally every episode builds on each other. So the past few seasons, they've done like season-long arcs, and they're hilarious. If I had to pick a new show that I'm most interested in, Supergirl maybe, but as of we record this, I'll be 2 episodes behind. I haven't seen enough to form an opinion. It's fun, but I think it's going to be Legends of Tomorrow for me. It's going to be the big thing that comes out that's got me excited.
Yeah.
Wow, I'm surprised. A lot of you guys just don't watch the same things. I mean, maybe.
I've been watching Blind Spot, and I'm behind. I'm not sold on it. I've tried a few other things. There's just not much new that came out that I was like, I've got to see this. I tried a couple, and I was like, pfft.
Really?
Blind Spot was, other than The Muppets, and I enjoy The Muppets, so out of the new shows, The Muppets the winner for me. Blind Spot was pretty far up there, but now it's transitioning in just to the weekly regular cop show, or federal government figuring out what's going on show, and there's not much... you got to stay with it, because I could see it evolving into something else, but other than the tattoos... and figuring out what's going on with the tattoos and who put them there and that sort of thing. And how did they know all this in advance? And Jamie Alexander, by the way, amazing actor on the show. So other than that, it's just not grabbing me like other things would grab me. And I will reserve judgment completely until maybe the end of the season, but it's quickly ratcheting down on my must list watch, and I'll catch it on the weekends if I have to catch up with it.
Fair enough.
I've also heard Into the Badlands was really good. It just premiered this Sunday. I've got it on my DVR. I want to watch it just because it looks like it could be a really cool martial arts show. It sounds like it could be a little wonky, but it's on AMC, so you know they're going to give it a chance.
Well, they've got it right now, right after The Walking Dead. So
yeah, that's in that magic time slot right there.
How about that? I wonder how Hardwick's feeling about that one.
Oh, and I guess I also have to admit, I've been watching Heroes Reborn, and it's a guilty pleasure.
Yes, it's fun.
It's fun.
It's not great. But it's not.
It still suffers from the same problems Heroes had before, where it's like, let's draw something out for four episodes, and then in two episodes make everything happen, and then make you wait four episodes again. But the twist this season has been really interesting that they put into play. So Heroes Reborn. Yeah.
You can see the budget's not fully there.
Right. The June 13th episodes, the back-to-back June 13th part one and part two, they were by far, they kept me in it because I was just about to shut it off again. I have watched all of the seasons, all the episodes of Heroes so far, and Heroes Reborn, it's getting interesting, but at the same time, I'm like, you know, some of the characters, I'm like, whatever, go away. I want to see something different. And what they're doing is they're closing off a lot of the stories from the original series. They're taking these actors and they're bringing them to their conclusion, and probably in an environment where then they can move on with a clean slate if they do another season next year. But if you were clamoring for additional Heroes content, this is definitely the show for you, and you will enjoy it if you haven't already. I assume you're watching it if you're a Heroes fan.
So guys, I might have inadvertently lied to you. I just remembered what I think is probably my favorite show I've been watching this year. And sure. It just popped in my head. No, Star Wars Rebels.
Interesting.
It's on my list. On my list, but I haven't.
Really good. I won't get into any spoilers for JS, but this second season, I wasn't too keen on season one. Then everyone told me about what happened in the season one finale. I watched that and I was like, holy crap, I'm sold on this. And every episode in season two has been fun. They've been bringing in elements of the Clone Wars, such as Captain Rex and his crew. You get mentions of them. It's been so good and so entertaining. It's tying everything together. And they've kind of teased that it's going to have some kind of connection into the greater mythos that we get established in Star Wars The Force Awakens. And I have no idea what it is, but I want to know. And it feels like Star Wars to me. If I wish I'd had this kind of cartoon when I was a kid instead of like the Star Wars Ewoks crap.
When we were kids, man.
When I was a kid, yes. But as a kid, I think I would enjoy this more because it's almost got... All right, how's the best way to put this? It's almost got that Pixar feel where it's geared towards kids, but adults can enjoy it too.
That's good, man. Because I have stuff that no one's even mentioned, which is surprising beyond belief.
Well, we're just not there yet. When the crew of the Ghost get back from that one planet that they were sent on that mission to obtain some information, basically, and I'll leave it at that. When they come back in the one scene with the crew, did you know that? And them just like, oh no, it just changed everything for them. And that other than the cameos, which have been widely reported, that particular scene just summed up the Star Wars Rebels. Is like, wow, this is a good show that they're actually showing that at a kid's level. That's incredible.
Jess, I think you'd probably like it. You're gonna have to bear with season one.
I mean, I have my favorites list. If you can look at my, favorites list. I'm just adding stuff.
Go with your favorites.
So I have a couple. I'll take a couple of minutes here because this is a subject to me that's really important. Ash versus Evil Dead is a masterpiece.
Yeah, I forgot about that.
If you are an Evil Dead 2 fan, Ash versus Evil Dead is bringing the series to the 21st century. I know it was filmed in the 21st century as well, but who cares? It's amazing. It's Evil Dead 2 as a TV series. It's as gory as possible. The comedy's back. The slapstick's back. It's awesome. Definitely a must. If you like Evil Dead, it's great. And the storyline's interesting. It's very fun. I started watching season two of Black Mirror, which I don't know if you guys have in the States.
I've heard very good things about it. It's on Netflix here. A lot of people have been watching it.
If you haven't watched season one, it's a must. It's great. Great. It's the quality is of the storylines, I would say, is probably as good as Game of Thrones. I mean, that's the quality of show. It's a movie on a screen, on a TV screen. Something that I have a guilty pleasure that is probably a horrible show, but I just like it because it's Captain Picard, Blunt Talk. I don't know if you guys have watched an episode yet.
I saw interviews on it, and if I had stars, I would be watching it because it looked hilarious to me. I just was not going to pick up another channel.
It's good. It's not great, but it's good. And for it's good. I doubt it's going to have a second season. And if it has a second season, it's not getting a third. Con Man is amazing.
It's on my list as well.
Con Man is
okay, Jess, you're naming a bunch of stuff that's on my list to watch. I just haven't gotten to it yet.
It's because you're too busy watching the other stuff that you have to podcast about.
That's right. That's right.
Honestly, is that you don't want to invest the time into a new show until you really know it's good, right? So, like Minority Report came out. I gave it 20 minutes. At 20 minutes, it didn't grab me out. I watched a couple of the other shows. I was like, yeah, Limitless. And I watched the entire full episode. Yeah, and some of the second episode. It's a good show. It just doesn't, for me, measure up to the other stuff that I'm watching. So that was out the window. So Muppets is just a guilty pleasure. It makes me laugh while I'm eating dinner, so I'll watch it.
Exactly. Yeah, that's it. Muppets for me, I'm still watching. I'm behind, but I mean, it's not the best show in the world, but it's enjoyable. The next show that I'm really into right now is Yumi and the Apocalypse. I every time a new episode comes out, I have to watch it. Great show. A bit of a reused storyline, but still very, very good. And season 2 of iZombie just started up. It's a good comic book. It's not exactly following the original comic book storyline. It does have some of the original comic book storyline.
I heard that it had a little more of the, shall we say, CW element in it than...
It does. Yeah. It does. It does. Yeah,
On CW. What did you expect?
I meant more than, like, even Arrow and The Flash. That's what I was told.
Yeah.
I was told.
It's okay because that's what it is. I mean, basically, that's what it is. Where that offended me on Arrow because that's not what I wanted to see. You know what I mean?
I don't know that I've ever been offended by a TV show.
Oh, I've been offended by many TV shows, my friend. There is there's some stuff out there that's pretty bad. Pretty bad.
I think we would be remiss if we did not mention Doctor Who. I know some of you on the podcast are not Doctor Who fans, but for those of you that have been keeping up, they had an episode a couple of weeks ago that everybody was just clamoring about that was probably people's favorite episode or close to the favorite episode since the reboot started in 2008. So it was phenomenal, and they followed it up by an absolute tanker. It's like one of the worst episodes possible, but on a whole, they're doing
what that
a great job
does, though.
Yeah, they're doing blocks of back-to-back episodes, so it's a continuation story, kind of like back to the classic Who, where you had serials of three or four episodes. They're doing two-parters, and they have been continuing a little bit of the story a little bit more, and then there's threads of an overall story in there, which you're kind of learning and whatever. And then, if you've been spoiled by the news, you kind of have a hunch of what's coming by the end of the series and by the Christmas special episode. So people are looking forward to that and looking forward to see how this series wraps up. And I hope they get better next episode, because this episode, I was like, what the heck? And our pals over at Gallifrey Public Radio did not care for it either. They had a chance to watch it together while they were at a small convention in Long Island, L.I. Who, and you go listen to their podcast if you really want their reaction. But the episode before was great. It was like the episode I was talking about before, 4722 on Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. That episode was the Zygon inversion or invasion. I can't remember which.
Invasion.
Well, yeah. They had two. One was inversion, one was invasion. So I think the second one was invasion. That was phenomenal. I absolutely loved it.
First one's invasion.
Okay. So the second one's inversion. Okay.
For me personally, I have to say my favorite has been Keeping Up with the Cardassians, the new spin-off of Star Trek. No. Honestly, come on, you know I lifted that joke. It's all over the internet, okay?
She just released a $75 book, which is
you've read it, right?
No.
Sorry. We should do a podcast on it so you can sample it. But anyways, no, seriously, I have to say this one here has won my heart, and I know it's going to be very surprising to hear me surprised about it because I did a podcast about it, but The Walking Dead won me back this year. Like, seriously,
really?
It has won me back. It's been very good. Yes, if you don't like the usual people die thing, you're probably not going to like it. However, for me, I think that it's very much fallen back in line with the feel of the comic, something that was missing for a very, very long time. And I really like how they are doing the separations of the groups this year, because we are getting a bit of that. And it's something that it's working this year, I think, because of the way that they've truly held the story together with one big arc, but there's so much that has been kind of, you've basically hit the ground running right from the start, and we've been seeing this dissected over the last few episodes in different factions, and it's working so well. Like, you knew within the first couple episodes what was, like, where the first half of the season was going, but now we're getting such a dissection of the individual factions. It just works very well this year. I quite like it.
Well, I think Chris would probably be better off touting the goodness of Walking Dead. I did bow out. I watched Fear the Walking Dead just to see where that was headed. Kind of enjoyed it for what it was because I wanted to see the beginning of the apocalypse, the zombie apocalypse, whatever. But I have elected to bow out of Walking Dead, and I know even my daughter was like, I can't believe you did that. This season's so good. I'm like, well, it's just not the type of show that I want to be watching. Just like I have bowed out officially now of Game of Thrones. I will not be continuing on in that series. So it's me, but I have heard wonderful things about it. If you're into the type of show that The Walking Dead is, it is amazing. And I think, what's his name? Scott Gimple. He's just got to be beside himself right now because he is doing everything that his fandom wants him to do.
Mm-hmm. Chris, any thoughts on it?
No, Walking Dead's been really solid this season. I wasn't expecting to enjoy it as much as I have. Andrew Lincoln continues to knock it out of the park. The only thing that maybe it's a minor complaint is I did not like the Morgan-centric episode. Not that I didn't like it, I just didn't like where it fit into things because it was a 90-minute gap that went back in time that did not continue the story we're getting.
You know, I actually didn't mind it when it played it, but looking back on the season, I have had a little more of an issue. The biggest thing that I had was that they extended that episode by 30 minutes and it didn't need it. I didn't think that it needed it.
I mean, it's a really good episode. It just doesn't really fit where they put it into things. That's all. Especially when you consider the fact that this whole first half of season, what is it, 5 or whatnot, takes place during one day.
Yeah.
Having one of those episodes be a flashback to something that takes place back in season 3 when Claire was taking place, it just didn't mesh well for me. It was really good. It just didn't fit.
Yeah, and the thing is, it really reminded me of that when they did the governor thing. It felt like a misstep almost. Like it was jolting.
How was the governor a misstep?
Oh, we won't get into that. No, the governor, two episodes that they did, when they showed back what happened post Woodbury.
At the end of
it wasn't me and the governor himself, but when they had the two flashbacks that show how the governor survived Woodbury and then fell in with another group of people. You're built up to like your certain core group of people, and it's fine to step away from them from time to time, but when person's name withheld here looks like they're dead and you still haven't found out, but you get a 90-minute filler episode right after that, it's a good episode, but if you're not solving that question of, oh my God, is person X dead? It's all
they're just driving right people here to come back the next week. That's all. Okay, because he thinks that he can do no wrong, that people are going to come back and watch it like everybody did. They might be dissatisfied with the Morgan episode, but they're going to come back.
They will.
And I don't think anyone was dissatisfied with what happened in the episode. I think they were dissatisfied that that's where we got it. It's really good.
Agreed. But we should go ahead and find out what the audience had to say. Should we do that?
Let's do it.
All right. So here's what we had. We went to the Facebook And this is kind of your hybrid into geek back, by the way. We could play a bump, but I'm not going to. We asked the question, we are at least a month into most of this year's geek TV. Which is winning for you? Which needs improvement? Any surprises? First response we had was Michelle Ealy. I'm happy how well Constantine worked into Arrow. Supergirl is okay so far. I think Barry is Zoom, so I want them to reveal who Zoom is soon on The Flash. And I like how S.H.I.E.L.D. keeps getting better. We had Steve Boyd say The Walking Dead is really good this year. Supergirl is off to a strong start. Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. I've been holding off on because I found they're more enjoyable and easier to understand when watched in groups. Flash is one of the best shows on TV right now. Arrow still just seems to be okay. I don't like the editing between scenes, but I loved Constantine's appearance and hope he returns soon. Ash vs. Evil Dead is a geek's dream come true. In between these shows, I'm watching The Last Man on Earth, which is a lot of fun. And then finally,
I couldn't get into that one.
Finally, we had Ash versus Evil, in my opinion. This was Griff Ekins. He said Ash versus Evil Dead. They took the camp of Army of Darkness and the true horror of the original Evil Dead and managed to put it into one series. So there you go. That's what you had to say about this. Just quickly touching on some of those points, the common threads there. I have to say I am very different than a lot of what people think. And I thought that the Constantine appearance, while fun, I thought that it felt very forced. I know people liked it, but I thought that it did not fit as smoothly as I would like to have seen. And then the other side of the coin there is, I think, contrary to what Steve Boyd says, I think The Flash has been constantly up and down this season, and no way near evoking the fun and the passion that I enjoyed of it last year. I think that it has been all over the place, and while I still have enjoyed it, Arrow quickly took the top spot between that and The Flash for me this year. And last year, The Flash managed to beat out Arrow, in my opinion. So flip back for me this year.
So, minor spoiler alert, this last Flash was awesome, just watching Zoom own Barry. Really good fight. I mean, and it's building up towards something that's going to be really cool. And I love the mystery of everyone trying to figure out just who Zoom is.
Can't you just check who the actor is?
Well, they use the voice of Tony Todd, but it is a body double in a suit that is full head to toe, completely covered. So he's got Tony Todd's voice, but we have no idea who he is. And it's
just like
it's
they did
fun.
The reverse Flash last year until they did the reveal. I think none of us have really touched deeply on Arrow. I want to say that Chris and I can speak for both of us, are really enjoying the series this year. It has been fun to podcast on. It's a fun show to watch. It is one of my top shows. We just didn't get to it probably because we talk about it so much, but it has been a consistent performer. The Constantine episode was a little out of place, but I think that they had to have it because of a tip of the hat to the Constantine character and the actor that played Constantine, to bring him back and kind of finish off his role, or at least give a good finish off to the role, because the series was cut short by NBC. And aside from that, the series has been pretty good this year, and I'm looking forward to, they set up, it is wonderful. I like shows that they do this. They set up a final scene, and we don't know when the final scene is. They said it's 6 months in the future, so it's probably in the May timeframe. But they set up a final scene, and we're just constantly trying to guess on what's going to happen when we get there. And the twists and turns that we've gone through already either cement it or take us in other directions. So it's just really fun to watch. And if you're invested in the show, it has not gotten worse by any means. Flash, I think the big three things that have been selling Flash this year are Zoom, Grodd, and the Shark King. The introduction of those three characters, everybody's like, oh my gosh, I really like Flash. Yeah. So if you're into comics, you like it. So,
by the way, I should say here in the chat that they are all over saying that season two is better than season one. I want to clarify, I am enjoying it. The biggest problem that I have is I feel like they're constantly having to over explain the world's concept for those who can't pick up on it. So it's becoming a little too, I don't know how to describe it, but I feel like they're constantly all over the map with the storyline when they are giving these breaks to explain things. So that's sort of how I'm feeling about it. And as such, it's not, I guess maybe I'm trying to say it doesn't flow as well as season one, I feel, but I still enjoy it. But yeah, like I said, I enjoyed season one better. But go ahead, Chris. Sorry, I cut you off.
So no problem. Real quick on Arrow, this is the last thing I'll say on it, is I think in order to set up magic in the Arrow universe, they couldn't have picked a better character than John Constantine to do that. I think that setup was perfect. It's a nice tie in, everyone that loved that show, and it gave them a nice ratings bump.
Yeah, agreed. Yeah. And overall, I've really liked Arrow. I think that it's just been some really good setup of Legends of Tomorrow, but still moving mm-hmm. Arrow along in a good direction. I don't know, yep. But I'm sure JS 100% agrees with me on that.
I'm actually going to give Flash a chance. I haven't given it a chance yet, but it's on my list. It's on my favorites list right now. I want to watch it. Everybody says good things about it.
You gonna pick it up at season two? You gonna start?
No, I'll start at season one. So I mean, there's 12 episodes. It's not
23. No, it's 24. A
full season.
Oh wow! Yeah, 23. Yeah. Well, whatever. It's gonna be 23 hours. It's gonna take me 4 days to watch.
I like your commitment.
I do too.
One final show that I just want to bring up real quick is Big Bang Theory. I know it's getting a little long in the tooth, but they're doing a good job this season, and they even brought Adam Nimoy in for an episode, which I absolutely applaud. They were doing a documentary on super fans of his father, and of course Sheldon was the key there, and Will Wheaton came on and Adam Nimoy came on, and so I salute them for tipping the hat to Adam Nimoy on that.
And if you want to go ahead and have your say, we encourage you to let us know through a variety of ways. You can find us at gunnageek.com. You can go ahead and write us on Facebook at facebook.com/gunnageek. Tweet us at gunnageek. Or please do call in our voicemail line at 567-343-GEEK. That's 567-343-4335. Please do let us know what you think. And as always, we are here live on Mondays at 5:45 p.m. Pacific. That's 8:45 p.m. Eastern at geeks.live. So come in and do what the chat's doing right now and tell us your opinions on the subjects right in the chat. And let's just say that all of them pretty much agree with all of us, because that's how perfect we are here on the Gunna Geek podcast. But that does take us towards the end of the show. I'm just going to go ahead and close here by saying that lots of great TV that is out there right now. If you are a geek, we live in a phenomenal time to check out a lot of great television, whether it's some of the more main titles like what SP, Chris, and I have talked about, or maybe some of the ones that JS mentioned, which may not be on the biggest radar, but are still things that have quite the following and are a lot of fun. There's a lot of really good content out there. And JS, I'm going to have to check those out after your recommendation.
Yeah, You Mean the Apocalypse is pretty good. You'll enjoy it.
Awesome. Chris, you got anything you want to talk about before we close here?
As I always do, I'll just say, go check out all the other great podcasts on the Gunna Geek Network over at gunnageeknetwork.com. I think we've got just about something to fit everyone's tastes.
Awesome. SP, yourself, you got anything you want to plug? Maybe Legends of S.H.I.E.L.D. available on the Gunna Geek Network at gunnageeknetwork.com.
Well, since you just did, I'll actually take my time and plug a show on Yahoo Screen. If you haven't already, pick up Other Space. It is just a fun, campy comedy. It's done by some people that you actually know, from Paul Feig to the actors involved. So go check it out. It's just fun. It's campy. If you liked, what was the BBC show? Somebody help me out.
Red Dwarf?
Red Dwarf. If you like the BBC show. Yeah, if you like the BBC show Red Dwarf, you will probably like Other Space. It's modernized, it's Americanized, similar sort of thing in a larger crew, but you will like it. So go check that out. That's on Yahoo Screen, which has, like we were talking about before, with Amazon Prime and Netflix, it has its own shows, and this is one of the shows it has, Other Space.
And JS, you got anything you want to plug? Maybe you wanted to bring it back and talk about your special project, your special show, the sensation of the French-Canadian sensation?
I got to say, if you play some video games or you play some console games and you enjoy the Fallout universe, Fallout 4 is a very good game to get. We spoke about it at the start of the show, but you should definitely get it. It's good. It's a bit bug riddled right now on the PC version. I haven't experienced that many of it, but a lot of people are reporting it. But a lot of people are very picky. It's a great game. The universe is such a beautiful universe. I've been a fan since its original release. I think it was like 96 or 95, the series that is. There's a bit of things that, being a big fan of the Fallout universe, that is, there's a little something that bothers me in this version. But apart from that, it's good.
Who's your companion, JS? Is it dog meat?
I'm actually changing companions. I've been using I used the dog. I used the Minuteman guy. I don't know his name. I used Piper for a while, and now I'm using Strong. I don't want to spoil who Strong is, but
I read one review, and the guy said the dog is so well done in this game. He goes, I literally had to stop using it as a companion because hearing it get hurt, it made me physically feel bad.
Yeah. It's a good game. It really is. They've done some beautiful stuff. Some of the complaints I have, the inventory system is really bad, but Fallout has always had, Fallout 3, since it became a first-person shooter type game, the inventory system is horrible. It's just bad. The fact that you can't even sort alphabetically, it's really bad. There's some continuity stuff that bothers me. I'm a huge Brotherhood of Steel fan, and in this version, the Brotherhood of Steel does things that don't follow its core principles. So I don't know if it could be something I just don't know yet, because I haven't followed the storyline far enough. But as a huge Fallout fan, there's some errors there. I don't know what the writers did or what was the idea behind it. It's the only complaint that I currently have. I don't have that many hours logged in. I think I have 13 hours. It's been out for a week, so I'm not that addicted like some people, I'm sure, have finished the game 18 times. but it's a good game. It's expensive. It's $79 US. It's pretty pricey for a game these days. But yeah, you should pick it up.
Awesome. Awesome. For episode 121 of the GunnaGeek.com podcast, Stargate Pioneer is now cast in The Walking Dead.
I watch way too much TV, I realize.
And I'm a dead man.
That's because you talked about SNASA.
Bye!
From everyone here at the GunnaGeek.com podcast, thanks for listening. If you like what you heard, please give us a 5-star review on iTunes. We encourage you to send your feedback by email to podcast@GunnaGeek.com. You can find all of our show history at GunnaGeek.com/official podcast. And while you're there, why not head over and check out all of the geeky podcasts on the Gunna Geek Network? The music heard on this show is by Kevin McLeod of Incompetech.com. Thanks for listening, and we will see you again next week.